Good morning to all of you. So we'll be starting with the life process chapter, chapter number 6 of class 10, and myself Kanupriya Sharma. So here we'll just have an idea of the whole chapter in this particular series. And as you can see over here, what are life processes? Life processes are those processes which are important for our survival, right? So here we can see that for our survival, we know that we have we need four basic, we need many processes, but four are main, which is nutrition for our food energy requirement, right? Then there is circulation or transportation, which is required for the movement of whatever we have taken to move it around in our body. Circulation is needed. Then there is respiration to break down the food that we have taken into usable form. And then excretion to remove the unwanted material. So these are the basic ones. Other than these, there are control and coordination and others. So let's just start with the having an idea. So here in this particular paragraph, what we are talking about is that we see plants around us. Some are looking green, some eat differently, but for every organism we see that they are alive, right? All the living organisms, they have the specific qualities which make them able to grow themselves and to make sure that they are surviving and they're breathing and all. So how do we tell that something is living and something is not living? So the basic difference between something living and something non-living is movements. I hope you all can see here. So is movement, right? So movement is something which... you will say that, ma'am, if we can move the table also, then we will say that it is alive. So I'm talking about molecular movement. What kind of movement I'm talking about? Molecular movement here, right? So molecular movements are the movements which make sure that we are surviving, right? Then here, now in this particular series, let me tell you first, I'll try to just give you an idea of the whole chapter and make sure that you all are understanding the basics of the chapter, the important points of the chapter. And once we are done with the basic of the chapter, then we'll move ahead. If there are any questions, you can ask in the comment section. So then there are molecular movement. We can't see them, right? So in living organism, things keep on breaking down and keep on making up and all of that. So that it is as a result of many chemical reactions. So then the point comes, essentially the name of the chapter. What are the life processes which we are talking about, right? So what are those life processes? So for us to maintain ourselves, we need some processes which are required for their maintenance. So these particular processes which help us to maintain ourselves and our function in our body, and we work out smoothly, and we are able to do whatever we want to do, and our things are going on. Like right now I'm teaching you, but how can I teach you? Some life processes are going on right now in my body which are making me comfortable enough to teach you. So these are called maintenance jobs and maintenance processes, and these are known as life processes which help us to survive and easily function, right? So the next point comes, these processes are needed to prevent damage and breakdown. So energy is needed for them. The first thing is whatever we are doing, we need energy for that. If we talk about something I need to repair at my home, so I need to feel good. And if I'm not feeling well, I'll not care about if something is going wrong or something, because I'm not focused enough and I am looking after myself. I'm taking care of myself. And so if I'm feeling good, then only I'll be able to do other things, right? I'll be able to clean up my, make sure that there is utmost cleanliness and things are at place. And if there's something is damaging, I'll repair that also. I'll try to do it myself, or otherwise I'll seek out help. But that is only possible when I have energy and my processes are functioning properly. So to start with, we need energy for anything, right? And though that energy that we take from outside is known as nutrition, right? Here you can see nutrition. So the nutrition is helps us to survive and carry on with all the processes which are there in our body. And the nutrition we get from the carbon source, right? We get all of that from the carbon source, right? Now in the single cell organism, the way they take up the carbon source is through simple means, by diffusion. But for the multicell organism, simple diffusion will not help, will not meet the requirement, and hence we need some other mechanism. We need organs, we need some systems to ensure that we are getting the nutrition, and nutrition is reaching to each and every part of our body, right? Now, to reach out the nutrients to each and every part of our body, we need a transportation system. We need oxygen, first of all, to break down the whatever we have taken. We need to break it down into a form which can be used by our body, and that can give us energy. And that is with the help of oxygen. So when we respire, the process is respiration. And when we respire, that's when respiration is nothing but taking up the oxygen and releasing the CO2 and taking up the oxygen and using that oxygen to break down the food items that we have eaten, right? To convert them into a form that cell can take, utilize, and convert that into energy currency, which is ATP, adenosine triphosphate. So let's just get back here. Now, for oxygen, for nutrients, everything is there, but it cannot be located in one area, right? It needs to move around in the body. So to make sure that it's moving around in the body, we need a transportation system. And that's when the play of circulatory system comes into play. And it makes sure that each and every cell is receiving all the required material in a proper amount. If you are taking it in a proper amount. Aisa nahi hai ki if you'll take it in less amount, then it will still make sure that every cell is getting. If you'll take less food, you'll feel less, you'll feel having less energy, not able to do a lot of things. And if you'll have proper amount of food, then you'll not feel like, you'll not be feeling energyless, because you have enough food and enough energy. Your body has made enough energy to give it to carry on with all the functions with efficiency and with proper form, right? Now, when chemical reaction use the carbon source and the oxygen for the energy generation, now once we are using it, yeah, right. I have eaten one packet of chips, and I'm done with the packet of chips, the packet, the wrapper itself has no use. It's something which I'm going to throw in waste bin. Similarly, whatever I've eaten, the chemical reaction, whatever has happened, some of the byproducts are not required by the body, and some are really harmful. They should not be inside our body. They need to go out of our body, and that process of throwing out the unwanted material into from our body is known as excretion, right? So if all these processes, the four I've talked about, the essential ones, if they're going right, then we'll not have any issue in our body. But if they are not, any of them is not functioning properly, like for example, if things are not moving around in our body in a proper way, or oxygen is not reaching on the time, or if we are not able to take proper amount of oxygen, or we are not taking energy food properly, then there will be consequences, and they'll not be good consequence. I mean, they'll not be good for our body, right? The first one comes is nutrition, right? So when I talk about nutrition, what is nutrition? Nutrition is taking up the food material and utilizing it by the body, right? So whatever we eat, we do utilize it. So how do living things get their food? Now it depends on living things. How do they get it? If it is an autotrophic organism, then it will take it from the help of sunlight and chlorophyll and raw material. What are the raw material which we are talking about? We are talking about CO2 and H2O. So here it will use this along with the, here you can see, over here. Yeah, that's my daughter making sound. So here you can see that, what is it? It is CO2 and H2 over here, you can see, and it's converting in the presence of chlorophyll and sunlight, it's forming glucose. So this is autotrophic mode of nutrition, and here three main processes take place: absorption of the light by the chlorophyll, conversion of the light energy into chemical energy so that it can be used by the plant, and the reduction of carbon dioxide into carbohydrate, which is finally broken down into the plants and gets converted into and gets stored in the form of starch, right? Now here here it is the leaf section of the plant, where you can see that a section of leaf where this epidermis, which is the covering part, upper and lower cuticle, which makes sure that there is unwanted transpiration doesn't take place. I mean, unwanted, the loss of water doesn't take place. And then there are chloroplasts, which contains chlorophyll, and there are guard cells, which are actually regulating the opening and closing of the stomata, which are tiny pores found on the leaves, right? Now, there are some activities here. This activity is basically about, we take up the, this is to check that the chlorophyll is responsible for the starch formation. So here we take two leaves, we take variegated leaf, and we make sure that they are de-starched, and then we keep it in the light, and then we put take their, with the help of alcohol, we take their chlorophyll out, and once they are not green anymore, then we put iodine on it. So basically what happened, when we de-starch them and when we put them back into the sunlight, then the areas which were having green portion were able to make starch, but the rest of the portion was not able to make the starch. So here it proves that the green area, which means the area which is containing chloroplast or chlorophyll, is able to make starch, and the rest of the portion, so that's why we need, hence it is proved that we need chlorophyll for the process of photosynthesis to take place. Okay, so this is the idea behind this particular practical. I'll discuss about the activities and all in some other video. Here I can just give you an idea about what this activity is all about. So here is structure of stomata, which is responsible for the taking up of two very essential components which are required for photosynthesis, CO2 and H2O. And guard cell makes sure that the the opening is regulated, and it also helps to remove the excess of water from the leaf, right? Next activity is about proving that CO2 is required for the photosynthesis to take place. So here you can see that there are two healthy potted plants, and in this particular plant, in one we have kept KOH and one we have not. So these are the plants which are, we kept them into the dark room to de-starch them, and then we kept them outside in the sunlight, one having KOH and the other one having nothing. Now after a day we see that, or after some time we see that one is not looking well and the other one is still blooming properly. So the reason behind it, the KOH has taken up all the CO2 here. So everything is available to the plant except the CO2 here in this particular plant. But in this plant, CO2 is there because it is not being absorbed by the KOH. It is not having KOH. This one is having KOH, which is absorbing all the CO2 present inside the plant. But here the CO2 is there. So because CO2 is there, so we need plant is photosynthesizing properly and having starch and energy to survive itself. So this is the reason why this proves that CO2 is required by the plant to survive. Okay. Then there's heterotrophic mode of nutrition, which basically has three main things we need to understand for this. One is parasitic mode of nutrition, in which one organism is dependent on the other organism. It doesn't hunt it or eat it like that, but it survives on its body, takes up the nutrition, survives only on the body. Like for example, ticks on the organisms. They make sure that they take up the energy from them and survive on the and harm them. Similarly, amarbae or cascata also takes up like that in the case of plants, right? Now, when it comes to the other mode is saprophytic. These are harmful ones. Now, saprophytic is one, they act like scavengers or they act like cleaners. Why? Because they eat up all the dead and decay material. They're dependent on dead and decay material for their survival. So they are basically doing the good part in the nature, but the parasitic one is actually harming the other organism, right? See here, you can see amar whale and ticks and lice. These are parasitic ones. And then comes the holozoic ones. Now, holo means complete, right? So they are the ones which ingest a complete soil material, digest it with the help of digestive enzymes, and then excrete the unwanted material. So the very simple example of it is nutrition in amoeba. Here you can see the food particle is going down, taken up by the pseudopodia, food vacuole formed, then it is being digested, and then the unwanted material is thrown out by the amoeba, right? Now it's a complex version is nutrition human beings, which is a detailed one, which I will take up in the next class. Till then, make sure that you are revising the topics, and don't worry, whatever doubts you have, post them in the comment section. We'll have this particular chapter in detail also. So thank you so much. Take care, everybody. Bye bye.